Maps were redrawn because of it. Civilizations clashed over it. It fueled the rise of one empire while causing the demise of another. European exploration brought Great Britain into a close encounter with Chinese tea. As the love for tea deepened and the profits soared, the story of the exchange of tea for opium is a story that rewrote the destinies of millions. How? Let's explore A Tempest in a Teapot, how the encounter and exchange of tea fueled British imperialism. The story begins centuries before, in China. The story goes that Shen Nong was drinking a cup of boiled water one day, and some tea fell from a nearby bush into his cup. He was delighted by the infusion, and thus tea was born. Tea drinking certainly became established in China many centuries before it had even been heard of in the West. It was the European exploration of Asia that led to the encounter of tea. Marco Polo first encountered tea when he traveled and wrote about it in his famous manuscript. In the 1500s, Jesuit Father de Cruz brought physical tea to Europe. When the Portuguese princess Catherine of Braganza married into the British royal family in 1662, she popularized tea in Britain and there was no going back.
Well, it didn't really become the drink of the nation where everybody could afford as much as they wanted until the past the 1860s. So it was a very, very, very long time before it became truly the drink of the British nation. And that's because it was still very expensive. It was taxed very highly until 1864, when the government reduced the tax to just a few pennies. But right through until the middle of the 19th century, it was continued to be very expensive.
Tea was not only a beverage in Europe, it was also widely known for its medicinal properties. The British East India Company was given a monopoly to trade in tea. With a 1,000% profit margin, tea was the most precious commodity of its time. Their trading was based upon barter. China was the only producer of tea. China had a monopoly in tea cultivation and was able to exact a high price for their tea, which was consumed as a luxury item around the world, and brought China a variety of riches. China carefully guarded its tea and manufacturing cultivation secrets. During the 1800s, China enjoyed an annual surplus of $26 million. China was not interested in trading tea for anything but silver.
Tea was one of those small daily luxuries which the British absolutely counted on, and Guangzhou, back then known as Canton, was the only place foreign traders could buy tea in China.
The East India Company needed a new way to trade for tea in the colonies. Their commodity presented itself in the form of opium, an addictive drug that the Chinese couldn't get enough of. The Chinese bought opium with the profits from the silver trade, and the British bought tea from the new opium profit. This trade became an indispensable part of the economy. Tea taxes funded railways, roads, and civil service salaries, among the many other necessities of running an emergent industrial nation. It was successful. The Chinese emperor banned opium in China upon finding out about its addictive and unhealthy qualities. The British then turned to Chinese smugglers to take opium into China. Soon, Lin Zexu, a Chinese governor, grew tired of the illegal trade and had 300 British sailors captured and held ransom for 300 crates of opium. The substance was then washed into the Pearl River, along with lime. Queen Victoria was alarmed by this and sent the British Navy to take over the Chinese ports. This was seen as a declaration of war, and the Chinese junk boats were sent as a retaliation. Just these faster boats and higher advanced technology led to a victory for the British. Soon, after what was known as the First Opium War ended, the British signed a deal with the Chinese that allowed opium to be traded legally in China once more. However, the Chinese were unable to keep up with the British demand for tea. A new idea was starting to take hold in London at this time. Tea must be secured for Britain. If China legalized the growth of opium, it would leave a crucial gap in the economic triangle. England would no longer have the money to pay for her tea, the wars in India, or her public works projects at home. Chinese-grown opium would put an end to the shameful economic codependence between the two empires, the unhappy marriage sealed by the exchange of two flowers. It was a divorce that Britain could ill afford.
The price began to be reduced when we started growing our own tea. And we started growing our own tea in India in the 1830s. The first Indian tea that was sold here in London was in January 1839. Now, obviously, that was cheaper because we were growing our own tea on our own territory in India. Before that, we totally relied on China, and the Chinese teas were very expensive. It led to all sorts of problems. So when we started growing our own tea, it became more available, it became cheaper, and so more and more people could drink it.
The Indian Himalayan mountain range resembled China's best tea-growing regions. Thanks to the Opium Wars, Britain had greater access as to where tea was grown and processed. If the manufacture of tea in India was to be successful, the British would need thousands of tea plant seed samples by the thousand, and the centuries-old knowledge of tea cultivation.
The task required a plant hunter, a gardener, a thief, a spy. The man Britain needed was named Robert Fortune. Robert Fortune was a botanist, a horticulturalist, at a time when botany and the natural sciences were on the ascent in Britain. The East India Company says to him, "We need to go back to China and hunt up some tea for us." They wanted really good tea stock from the very best gardens in China. And they also needed experts. They needed the Chinese to go to India to teach the British planters as well as the Indian gardeners.
Robert Fortune was successful in retrieving thousands of tea plants to send back to the tea plantations in Darjeeling. Within a century, India's tea plantations would outstrip China's in quality, price, and volume. India, meanwhile, was to become an ever more critical asset to Britain, if Britain could even manage to hold on to it.
Has pretty much never really come back from that, certainly not in the Western markets. Now that Asia has such a booming economy, the Chinese are again pretty fierce tea producers, but it took 100+ years.
The exploration encounter and exchange of tea was connected to many events that affect us even to this day. One kingdom fell while another rose. Some empires fell to pieces, while others attained new prominence. The rise of the British Empire was solidified by the trade of tea and opium. Nearly a fifth of all income during this period was from the tea trade. The Chinese suffered an extremely humiliating defeat after the Opium Wars. The proud people did not appreciate having to give away so many of their ports and cities to the foreigners. When the British stole the Chinese tea, it was like rubbing salt into their wounds. This gave rise to Chinese nationalism. Because of this, the Chinese people rebelled, overthrew the Qing dynasty, and allowed the Kuomintang, better known as the Chinese Communist Party, to rise to power. In Europe, these events corresponded with the Industrial Revolution. Tea had nothing to do with it, but the drink was successful in promoting the British into a powerful state. The rise of tea gave rise to new economies in previously ignored nations. The sugar industry flourished. The tea trade connected Chinese coolies to workers in America, bankers in Bombay, and children in Manchester. The exploration encounter and exchange of tea is a nail-bitingly exciting tale. So, the next time you sit down and stir a cup of tea, see if you can taste its cultured history.